What are we going to do today? I'm going to have a bit of a look at the question of what data sets, quantitative data sets, can we use in educational research? And I'm not going to give like a comprehensive overview of everything that's out there, because that's really a bit more than what is possible in this relatively short time. So I'm going to talk a bit about some of the ones I'm more familiar with. To go through what we can do with them, also what we can't do with them, because all these data sets, of course, have their limitations as well, and give some examples of how we can use them going through that. So, start with, it's worth saying that in England, we are actually, when we look at educational data sets, we're in quite a privileged position. We probably have the most extensive educational data sets in the world in terms of covering large numbers of students, covering large numbers of variables, etc. We've got various school level data sets that we can access. We've got national pupil databases, we've got school censuses, we've got Ofsted inspection databases. There's a lot out there, and a lot more than in most other countries. Certainly compared to most of the European countries I work with, you wouldn't have that richness of data. Another interesting source, and it's worth pointing out that all these are also freely accessible to you, are the international studies. And all of you will have probably heard the words PISA come up now and again. We'll have a look at that one and some of the other ones as well. So, first thing, and really the simplest data set for anyone to get hold of, is really the traditional schools league tables data set, school level performance data. Now, up till quite recently, if you wanted that data, that was a little bit complicated, and if you went onto the Department of Education's website, you had to type in individual schools, etc., to find it. They've actually made it more easy now. If you go on to the website now, you can actually download the whole underlying data set. So if you go, say, to secondary school equivalents, you can go down the table and it says underlying data is available on the download page, and you can just click on the Excel link and you will have, if I click on open as well, of course, the full data set that is used for calculating the school league table result. So that is one thing that has changed. It's part of the government's sort of drive to put all data online, like that sort of police crime website and things like that. And basically, it's just this stuff: name of schools, addresses, various outcome data. It's data like the key stage attainment data, it's special needs data, so who has been identified as school action plus, statemented, etc. Then some data on other school factors, it's comprehensive and academy, all through school, etc. Some data on intake characteristics, but not all. So, for example, what it doesn't have there is free school meal eligibility. Now, in terms of what we can do with that data, it's relatively limited. But one thing I have used with colleagues in teaching in the past is this graph. What that is percentage of pupils identified as having special educational needs in four schools in one local authority, not a million miles away from the university where I used to work. And what that is very useful for, simple data, simple to analyze, but good to start a discussion as to, okay, why do we have these differences? Why would we have different percentages of pupils eligible for pupils with special needs in different schools? What are the correlates of that? What goes with that? It's quite an important question, and one which obviously is quite strongly related to factors such as pupil intake, free school meals, and also outcome measures as well. So that's one example of what we can do. Now, these data sets, easy to get hold of, easy to analyse individual school data, so you can make some interesting comparisons there, but a lot of missing variables. We don't have good data on socioeconomic status, for example. Aggregation to school level, and statistically that's a bit of a problem, not least as the variance within a school is larger than the variance between schools, so kids' results differ more within a school than results differ between schools in many cases. There is a problem also with the data as it's aggregated, in the sense that you don't see differences in performance of different groups within the schools and things like that. So it's limited data, but data that can be quite useful, also set a context for case study research, etc. So that's one set of data. Second one you will all be well familiar with is the Ofsted database. Now, Ofsted, you can get, of course, from their website, you can get individual reports on any school you want. This will all be put, I presume, somewhere on the website, so you can find those URLs and stuff later on. But what Ofsted allows you to do is obviously look at each school's inspection data, and interestingly, you can have both the qualitative data and also the quantification of that in terms of schools being given grades for things like teaching quality, leadership, etc. So it's quite interesting data. Now, of course, I don't need to tell you that it's also very problematic data in many ways. I mean, positive is it's broader than the performance tables in that you can actually look at different facets of the schools. There's some attempt to look at factors that go beyond the academic outcomes, so there is some attempt to look at things like how good is the school at providing a safe environment, how good is the school at providing well-being, things like that are in there as well. The interesting thing is that you can link this data to the other data sets, so using individual school numbers you can actually link that all. Big problems as well though. Firstly, schools are all inspected at different times, so you may want to know something about factors that influence school performance in 2009, but you'll find your last inspection report is from 2006 or something like that, and then for another school it could be 2007, etc. Big questions about the reliability and the validity of the data. So how confident can we be that when an inspector sting teams goes into a school and rates a school, say, outstanding on quality of teaching, that that is actually reliable data, and that a different inspection team who went into the same school would give the same rating? That's a bit of a question mark, because the training for inspectors is not that extensive, and one thing that we know from a lot of our research is that if you do things like ratings and classroom observation stuff, you actually need a lot of training to achieve reliability across raters. To give you an example, a number of years ago I was involved in research using extensive classroom observation in primary schools, and it took us 2 weeks of intensive training to ensure that all the observers would reliably rate at the same level, the same lessons. So it takes a lot of training, more training than you typically get if you go and inspect something. So that's a problem. Another problem is that the terms of reference change. So what's in an inspection report from 2005 is not quite the same as what's in an inspection report of 2009, because government policies dictate what things they look at to an extent. So it can become difficult to sort of match those over time. So that's a disadvantage. Now, how good a set of data is that then? There's a lot of discussion about that. Some people say because of those problems of reliability and validity, it's not very good data to use in educational research. Other people say, well, actually, when you look at it, when you look at the relationship, those data are quite a good predictor of school outcomes. So, for example, my colleague Pam Sams has done a lot of research using this data, and she says notwithstanding those problems, there is actually a strong correlation between Ofsted data and school outcomes. I do have one problem with that, which is the causality might be the other way. Inspectors go into a school, and if it's doing well, they will rate it more highly. One thing I found a while ago doing research on this type of data myself is that there's a big, what we call a halo effect, which means that all the variables that they look at are related to one another. So the impression that I get is people go into a school, say this is a good school or not so good school, and then everything is good or everything is not so good. So the distinction between the different things happening in the school, teaching, leadership, etc., is not as strong as you would expect it to be if they were all rated separately. There's also the very interesting finding, if you look over time at inspection reports, that the quality of leadership in schools has improved tremendously and has become more and more outstanding, but that has not been followed by a similar increase in performance. So there's clearly some issues there. So I would urge some caution in using that data, notwithstanding that it does bring some useful things. The main data set I use in my own research is the National Pupil Database and School Level Census. That is really the one data set that is pretty unique to the English system. Collects data, anybody who has worked in a school will be familiar with the various forms that need to be filled in for that, but collects data for each pupil every year on factors such as, are they eligible or not for free school meals? What is their ethnicity? What's their gender? So a whole range of pupil background data. Also, the results of all the statutory tests are in there, so GCSE, Key Stage 2, Key Stage 3 teacher ratings, etc. Total, it's about, the whole thing altogether is about 600 variables, so really quite a large and extensive data set. On all pupils in England, that's in a typical year in secondary, that will be around 600,000. So very large and very useful data set. It's not freely available, it's not just out there. You can understand that for the reasons of confidentiality, etc., that are involved with that. The full data set, for example, contains things like pupils' postcode. Now, you can see the worries if you've got somebody's postcode, you are quite narrowing down where they live, etc., so that becomes a bit difficult. However, you can request this data from the Department for Education. They're usually quite helpful in providing you with data as long as you've got a clear motivation for why you want it and it's not something they worry about. So obviously, if you went to the government and say, I want to write a critique of coalition education policy and I would like some National Pupil Database data, that's probably not the best approach to take. But generally, they are quite helpful. What they do have is a number of variables they will not release so easily, what they call confidential variables, and that's mainly those things which make it most easy to identify individuals. Again, that is understandable. You also have to sign a whole set of papers telling them how you're going to ensure confidentiality and you're supposed to destroy the data after you've used them and things like that. Obviously, what you don't want to do is leave your laptop on the train with all the data. So if anybody was interested in using that data, please feel free to have a chat and I can tell you what form and stuff you need for that. The great thing about the data set is the unique pupil number. Each pupil has that number that follows the pupil throughout their educational career, and that means that you can actually create longitudinal data sets following pupils basically from Key Stage 1 right up to Key Stage 5 through those linked numbers. Those numbers are linked to their establishment numbers, so you can link those individual pupils to the educational establishment they are in, school, nursery school, whatever. So again, you can follow through, you can see that change from one school to another, and you can do various statistics that allow you to link the school level and pupil level factors and allow you to see changes, effects of schooling, etc. So that's really quite a unique opportunity to look at progress longitudinally, which we don't have necessarily that often in educational research because it usually takes up so much money and time to collect that kind of data. So a wide range of data in that file, a lot of different variables. Outcome data, of course, and that's sort of cut in various ways, individual GCSEs, key stage two test results in different subjects, etc., by teachers, evaluations by tests, etc. So there's all that in it. Lot also of input data, gender is there, ethnicity quite in some detail, free school meal eligibility, index of deprivation affecting children code. So there's a whole set of data. Is that perfect data? No, of course not. There are limitations to that. For example, it would be better if we had data on parental, occupation, education levels as our background variable rather than the things we've got, but that would obviously place an additional burden on schools to collect that data, so presumably that's why it's not in there. We also have data on school characteristics. Again, is the school comprehensive, academy, things like that. Is the school mixed, faith school, so you can do all those kind of comparisons between academies, faith schools and what have you. That's quite useful as well. So that's really a highly valuable database. Reliability, as I said, no good data on socioeconomic status. Ethnicity data I always find a little bit questionable as well. Firstly, a large proportion of non-responses there. A lot of people, 10% typically in a year, do not answer that question, up to 20% sometimes. Secondly, the categories, okay, you can question how that categorization is done. I find some of the categories a bit unusual, personally, it's the similar one that you see in the census. A big omission for me is no classroom level data. That would be really useful because one of the things that we know from sort of educational effectiveness research is that the classroom is more important than the school. So there are more differences in terms of pupil results depending on what classroom they're in than there are depending on what school they are. So the teacher is more important than the school. Not so surprising, but certainly something that is statistically well supported. So what would be really useful for us is to know which teachers these pupils have so we could look more at classroom processes. Again, a problem, as also with the offset data though, to a lesser extent, is sometimes different data suddenly become collected or the definition of a variable may change. So if you say look back to the databases of 1998, they're not quite the same in terms of all the variables collected as the other data sets now. But the differences are limited compared to the differences in the offset data set. Of course, you get policies coming in like the English baccalaureate. If you go back, say, to the data of 2005, you will not find a column has or has not reached English baccalaureate, but it will have every individual GCSE subject in, so you can reconstruct that data. You know whether they have done a language or whether they have done history or whatever. Now, to give you an example of the kind of things you can do with this data, I'll present a little piece of research I did myself where we created a kind of quasi-experimental design. And what is one of the interesting things that you can do with this database is because you've got that amount of variables, you can use statistical methods to look at interventions and say, okay, these schools have been in an intervention, now can I find schools that are as similar as possible? I use a method called propensity score matching to do that. And what you can do is then basically create a quasi-experimental design where you've got intervention schools and your comparison schools for that. In this study, I'm going to show what I did something a little bit different, in the sense that I collected a bit of additional data from schools which they could just draw off their own management information systems to look at their particular educational question, and that is what factors influence what set pupils end up. So our hypothesis was, not a surprising hypothesis, that attainment, ability, will not be the sole predictor of what set people end up in. Other factors, such as background, gender, etc., may also predict what set pupils end up in. So in order to find that out, we did a couple of things. Firstly, we asked schools to tell us which pupils were in which sets in the subjects English and Maths. So we asked pupils to just run us off the list from their management information systems of which pupil numbers — we did not ask for the names because we don't need to know that — are in which sets. So we got a list saying, for example, number 2375082 is in set 1, etc. Number 56CBHQ23 is in set 2, etc. That's the kind of numbers you get with that. For each school that took part, we looked in total about 50 schools. What we did was specifically ask for data from year 7. Why year 7? Because we wanted to be able to look at the impact of both prior attainment and other background factors. And we know end of year 6 they get tested, key stage 2 test, so in year 7 they have fresh data on that kind of those latest attainment levels. If we were, say, to look at year 8, then already their latest data that we had access to would be from year 6, so we'd have more of a time lag there. So you probably don't want to know the exact statistical technical thing, but we fitted what we call a multinomial logistic regression model for ordered responses for both those variables, put in a number of predictors: prior achievement, gender, special needs, free school meal, eligibility, ACORN data. ACORN is, if you've got a postcode of somebody, you can actually stick that into a piece of software and it will classify the postcode for you. What it is based on is a whole set of data, census data, various survey data, consumption data, etc. It is — I don't know if any of you has used the website upmystreet.com. Yeah, it's like one does when you buy a house or something, you want to know what the area is like, you type. That's the ACORN system. When it comes up with those little vignettes saying, in this area, most people read the Daily Telegraph and go on holiday once a year and typically possess 2 cars per family, that's ACORN data. And ACORN classifies people into 56 different categories. Now, it's meant for market research purposes. That's why there's so much stuff on what they read, where they go on holiday, so that if I wanted to sell you Daily Expresses, I would know whether this was a good — I had a good chance of selling you one or not. But when you actually look at the category, it's actually quite a nice proxy for social class. It actually is relatively hierarchically structured, so it's quite useful for that. So we used that. We used ethnicity. We looked mainly at the larger ethnic groups. So what did we find? So what we basically did is we plugged in the data from the schools on which set people were in into the national pupil data sets. We merged them using those unique pupil numbers. We find prior achievement, i.e. the results in the key stage 2 SATs, was the strongest predictor of what set they went in. So as you would expect, people who have done well at key stage 2 tend to end up in higher sets. However, all these other factors were significant as well. Free school meal, eligibility, income, special needs, and ethnicity were also significant. So somebody with eligible for free school meal was more likely to end up in the low set, even taking into account her or his prior achievement. Similar, somebody with special needs. Ethnicity was an interesting one in that we found that white British pupils, taking into account the other factors, were more likely to end up in the middle sets, whereas black Caribbean pupils in particular were more likely to end up in either the higher or the lower sets. Why that is, that's a very interesting question. Probably take some qualitative research to find out the processes underlying that. So, quite interesting findings. What we also find, and because we can look at both the school and the pupil levels, we find that what school you go to makes a difference as well. So taking into account your own prior achievement, your ethnicity, etc., you still have a higher chance of being in a high set in some schools than in others. So what we had found first was, colleagues had done kind of qualitative studies, that if you ask people about how do you make setting decisions, they say one of two things. It's either attainment or ability. And all these other things, they obviously don't matter. When you actually looked at statistically, there is evidence that those other things matter as well. So there are obviously equity consequences to that, as you can imagine. So that is a bit of an example of what we can do with the National Pupil Database. And there's various things we can do with it, notwithstanding some limitations in the data as well. Some statistical stuff which I won't go over too much now. Now, as well as all these national data sets, and there are more out there, for example, a good source of data is the TLRP program. So if you go to the ESRC TLRP website, there are quantitative data sets that are made available there to researchers as well. Some very interesting stuff. But what we also have increasingly are the international studies. International studies have kind of, over the last 15 years, taken a real kind of flight forwards. There are more of them than ever. They're bigger than ever. That's really probably been one of the big growth areas in educational research. Also, you can see that a lot of these are influential politically as well. You will see the whole thing about Finland at the moment. Where does that come from? That comes because they do well on some of those international tests. Whether that is, how valid that is, that's another question which we'll look at a bit more. Some examples, TIMSS, PISA, PIRLS, those are three big international studies that have freely accessible databases. TIMSS is the Trends in International Maths and Science Study. I always have to pause when I say trends because it used to be Third International Maths and Science Study, but it's changed its name as they have been more and more. Funded by an organisation called the IEA, International Education Association. So that is a non-profit organisation, non-governmental organisation. Looks at two subjects specifically, maths and science. The first International Maths and Science Studies was in the 1960s, the second one was in the 1980s, the third one was in the 1990s, and you can now see they're coming ever faster. See, there was one in 2007, there's going to be one this year as well. So, and this is something you see with all these international studies, they kind of are accelerating in the numbers that have. 20 countries took part in the first teams, and every study there were more and more of them. Yeah?
It's probably worth emphasising the political interest, because yeah, it's funded by IEA, but the countries who participate pay money.
That's
so
right.
It's the political masters who say we will enter this competition because we want to be higher.
Yeah. Higher or not so higher, that depends. Sometimes it can be politically interesting not to be higher, because that's where you can then put in a big education. So there are different motivations, but certainly the political interest is very large. And the key use to which those tests are made in political sense is league tables. Where are we on the league tables? I remember when I first came to England, they had done the 95 teams, and the rhetoric around that was this: we've done really bad in this 1995 teams test, so we need to change our maths teaching. That's one of the things that was argued as the basis for the national numeracy strategy at the time. Interestingly, if you actually looked at the results, England actually came somewhere in the middle. So all the rhetoric was England was somewhere at the bottom. That actually wasn't true. England was somewhere average. So the way those things are used politically is very interesting. No, that's an often a little bit dubious. Now, you can find the TIMS data very easily again. You can just download it, and it comes, usefully it comes with a whole set of user guides and manuals. That's quite important with these international studies, because often some of the variables are constructed in quite a complicated way, and it's important to know how you can and cannot use them. PISA in particular has that. You can download them as SPSS data or SAS data, two of the main kind of statistical software analysis packages. Now, when we look at that data set, as I said, the use that's made of it is typically, let's have a look at where we are on the league tables. In Belgium, what we always do is we say, okay, how are we doing compared to the French-speaking Belgians? And if the Dutch-speaking Belgians are doing better, then we are happy. So that is, and in, I know colleagues here are working in Wales, they compare themselves to England and Scotland and stuff all. So that is the most common use. However, it would be wrong to think that that is actually what this study is about. There's actually a lot more there than just those outcome, those test results and those league tables. These studies actually collect a range of data on classroom processes, on school processes, which are quite interesting. There are even a number of sub-studies which use classroom observation, which you can access as well. So there's actually quite a lot of interesting data there, and there's been some use made of that by researchers in general to study not just outcomes but also processes in terms of teaching, in terms of school climate and things like that between different countries. So the data, you almost never hear about that sort of in the media, but there's a lot more there than you might imagine. Similar thing with PISA. PISA is probably at the moment the most kind of well-known international study. PISA is funded, is organised by the OECD, the Organisation for Economic Cooperation and Development, usually sort of seen as an organisation of the rich countries. And whereas TIMS is maths and science, PISA focuses on literacy as well. And what they do is every time they do a PISA, they test on literacy, maths and science, but they've got one kind of subject they major on. So they will do additional work on one particular area. So for example, in 2009, the major area was science, but they did also collect data on literacy and mathematics as well. Latest PISA, 32 countries and 11 partners. Again, it is nobody has to take part in this. The participation is voluntary, and usually, again, political considerations play a key part in that. Looking how well, again, we can do in these league tables. PISA, again, can be quite easily accessed. Got a website, gives you some latest findings, but also quite a lot of the actual data. And manuals, etc. One of the complex parts of PISA is the way the outcome measures are actually constructed, because they use quite a complicated form of something called item response theory. So it's not a question that you just have a score for each pupil. So that's one of the kind of things to consider a little bit before you decide to use this data set. There is a complexity there, and you need to be aware of that. And it explains it in the guidebooks, but it's still best to read some stuff on item response theory before you attempt to do this. PISA, again, mainly used for the league tables, has had a very strong impact in some countries which felt they did badly in them again. In Germany, they never shut up about it. Every time you go to Germany, a piece of piece, and they basically use this again as a way to introduce educational reform. Similarly, our new government has mentioned PISA quite a few times in, again, both criticising the previous government and introducing education reforms. So that is, again, the most common use to which it is made. Again, that is a shame because there are a lot of other variables collected. There's a lot of data. There's data in that on classroom processes, things like leadership, climate. There's surveys of pupils, surveys of educators. So again, there's quite a lot more data there than you would think from the kind of lead table approach. PIRLS, finally, is the little sister of TIMSS and is the reading version of TIMSS. So TIMSS was maths and science, PIRLS is reading achievement. Find it on the same website. Studies in 2001, 2006 and 2011 appears to have less political impact than PISA. People talk about PIRLS less. Why that is, don't know. Maybe after 2011 we'll have PIRLS league tables and we will be told either that we have done very well or very badly on this, and either this will mean the government has done really well or it will be a spur to more education and reform. So, how good are these studies? How useful are they? Well, first thing to say is leak tables is what you'll hear about them, but there is really a lot of other data in there that you can use. A rather strange use is this sort of fact, it's not actually research, but it's sort of a fact-finding mission. Governments see that particular countries do well in these tests. And what they then do is they sort of visit these countries and they pick out particular aspects of education policy there that interest them and take those back. It's quite an interesting process because it's nothing like research, but it's kind of using this type of research to half learn and half support existing ideas, I think, in many cases. So it's very interesting to see what different countries take as the lessons from that. For example, in Germany, where they've got all these reforms from PISA, one of the things they do is they look to England and they say, England has got all this school-based management, we don't have that, that's what we need. England has got all this leadership, we don't have that, that's what we need. England, on the other hand, says, well, we are not doing that well, we go look to other countries. Finland was briefly very popular. That's, they brought in the Masters in Teaching and Learning because of the Finnish example there. Sweden has recently become more popular, even though they're not doing that great on those tests themselves either. However, there is a lot more data, and the data is actually in many ways quite good. Firstly, it is really useful to have these international studies because, again, for us to do those ourselves is very expensive, very time-consuming, not easy. They are actually pretty carefully constructed. International committees construct the data, the variables, the tests. That is a time-consuming and carefully done process. There's a lot of statistical experts involved in that. So the reliability of the data in that respect is pretty good. Range of variables is interesting, and obviously the fact that you can now study changes in times. It's not longitudinal because you're not following up cohorts in the way that you can with the National Pupil Database. So you're not following an individual pupil from 2001 to 2006, for example. It's new pupils, but you can see changes in the sort of cohort averages over time. Problems though. Okay, first question. You're doing an international test of, say, mathematics. What items do you put in your test for 35 countries? 35 countries which have different views of what matters, differences in curricula, things are taught at different times, so in one country probability may entered key stage two in another country that may be in year five of secondary. So how do you construct a test that is fair for all the countries that are taking part? That is one of the key challenges to these things. And that is something you can never fully resolve. What has happened is that over time, these tests have become more international. When you look at the early first international maths and science study and the second one, they were quite US focused. So they were quite closely aligned to a typical US curriculum. That has become less so over time, so the tests are more international. But of course, none of these tests will be accurately aligned to the curriculum of any single country. There are also more fundamental questions. What matters? What kind of things do we prioritize? Knowledge, problem solving, what kind of things do we find important to test? Again, there are differences, and for example, if you look at Timms and Pisa, they look at the same subject in a somewhat different way. Various problems of the context. What is a year group? That is actually not the same thing necessarily in different countries. Year five in one country may not be the same age group as year five in another country. People start at different ages. I started school at 6 years old. England, you start earlier, some countries you start late. Curriculum, we've talked about. How important are these tests within the culture? I know of a good example of a difference there. In England, these international tests are relatively unimportant from the point of view of the school and pupils, because they are not part of the accountability system. This individual school will not be judged on how the pupils do in the PISA. They're judged on, as we know, SATs, GCSEs, so that's what matters. So this is relatively low priority. I know of one example of school in another country where, on the other hand, every pupil who was going to do the TIMSS test was invited to the podium. The whole school applauded. They marched off with music and stuff into the testing room and did the test. You are creating, obviously, a different atmosphere for doing that test, which may clearly influence the results. It suddenly becomes a much more high-stakes operation. What are our values? How important are tests and stuff generally in our systems? How you start kids to doing this kind of stuff? That does differ as well. Some countries don't have a national testing system, for example. So there are clear problems with those international tests and with making those comparisons between countries. Also, think about questionnaires. You're asking people about something like classroom climate. Okay, how can we be sure that a pupil in one country will interpret a question like, I get a lot of support from my teacher, in the same way as a pupil from a country in a different continent? That's not necessarily going to be the case at all. So there are clear issues with that as well, with those comparisons. However, those data sets still do something that none of us individually can do, which is provide comparative data from 2030 countries. None of us can do that in our individual studies. So that makes them very powerful and very useful. Likewise, the data sets that we have here in England ourselves are very powerful, very useful, with the caveats and the limitations they have. So my feeling is that with all the limitations, we are often too quick not to use them because those limitations are there. What we mustn't forget is that any other piece of research we do will also have its limitations. For example, typically in our own studies, we may have been very careful in terms of things like defining variables, measurement, etc. But one thing that we are often quite bad in is sampling. A good random sample is a rare beast in educational research. With national data sets, we can create one ourselves. So I think they are often a little bit underused. However, what we do need to do more of, and I hit myself on the head with that one, is link more these educational data sets to other data sets that are out there. Area studies, social surveys, etc. And that to me is kind of a next step forward.